Hello, I'm Ben Godwin. Welcome to the Word Workshop, recorded at the Good Springs Full Gospel Church.
God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy.
My wife Michelle and I have pastored the Good Springs Full Gospel Church since 1999, a spirit-filled church with a hunger for God and a heart for people. Good Springs Full Gospel Church is located in Walker County on Highway 269, 10 miles south of Jasper.
The prophet said that the knowledge of the glory of the Lord will cover the earth as the waters cover the sea.
So prepare your hearts to receive from the Word, because when all else fails, God's Word works.
Praise God. Well, go with me in your Bibles, if you will, please, to the book of 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel, chapter number 22. We'll get there in just a moment. Praise the Lord. Spoiler alert, God wins. I've read the last page of the last book, amen, and we come out on top. This made me laugh. To be an atheist, I would have to believe nothing produced everything. Non-life produced life. Randomness produced precision. Chaos produced order. I simply don't have that much faith. It's a lot easier to just believe in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth for a purpose, not just an accident. Amen? We have a purpose. And this made me laugh, too. I used to be lost without Jesus, but look at this tag, not no mo. Look at somebody say, not no mo. Amen. I'm glad. Welcome to Alabama. You're going to need one of these. And a good lawnmower, because the grass is growing. I saw this, and it cracked me up. Alabama forecast says more rain. Good. My backyard is looking a bit dehydrated. But the Lord knows what we need, right? He cools it off. Go with me to 2 Samuel 22. I'm going to use for a subject this morning, hinds feet on high places. And I will let you know immediately, I borrowed that title. That is actually the title of a book that's been out for some time in a devotional series I have not read either. But I love the title and I love the thought. And I want you to come away with this thought today. Don't settle for the plains. Don't even settle for the plateau. God wants to take you higher. How many want to go higher in God than you've ever been? That's my heart's desire today. The term hind, H-I-N-D, is used in the King James Version 10 times in reference to a female red deer which lives in the mountains. Three times this nearly identical verse appears in Scripture with it as a powerful spiritual analogy. Here's the verse, 2 Samuel 22, 34, Psalm 18, 33. They are verbatim. Will you read it with me off the screen? He maketh my feet like hinds' feet and setteth me upon my high places. It occurs in those two passages and also in Habakkuk chapter 3 and verse 19, a little slight variation, and we will look at that a little bit later. But the context of these verses is very important to understand the meaning. 2 Samuel chapter 22 and verse 1 gives us the context. David spake unto the Lord the words of this song in the day that the Lord had delivered him out of the hand of all his enemies and out of the hand of Saul. So David is celebrating God's deliverance. How many have seen God work in your life and you can celebrate his deliverance? Somebody just say, thank you, Jesus. David at this time was probably in his late 50s, early 60s in his life. And remember, he was a fugitive from King Saul from anywhere. Bible scholars estimate somewhere between 7 and 10 years he was on the run. As a fugitive, being chased down like an outlaw. But God was with him every step of the way. Hallelujah. It's interesting to me that David's first major battle was against a giant. Everybody knows about that, right? Goliath. Did you know this? David's final battles were against four more giants. And you read about that in the previous chapters, verses 15 through 22. So remember when David went out to fight the Goliath, what did he do? He didn't use Saul's armor. He used what he knew, his slingshot, right? He had not proven that armor. Notice this. This is an interesting contrast. Saul was professional, but he was unanointed. He had lost the anointing. David was unprofessional, an amateur, but he was anointed. Who brought the giant down? Are you hearing me? It's not our talent, it's not our skill, it's not our ability, it's not our knowledge or our intellect, hallelujah, that wins the battle. It's the anointing, hallelujah. God's dunamis, the power of the Holy Spirit. Praise God. And so what did David do? He bent down and he picked up what? Five smooth stones. A lot of preachers have had a lot of ideas about that. I like to say J-E-S-U-S. But why did he pick up five stones? Some say, well, that was just extra ammunition in case he missed his first shot. Maybe, could be. I happen to think it was more prophetic. I happen to think it was a statement of faith. That David was saying, not only is God going to help me defeat this giant, he's going to help me face Goliath's either brothers or sons that I'm going to face down the road. So God's not only going to help me win this battle, he's going to help me win every battle. God's not only going to help me defeat this giant, God's going to bring down every giant in the name of Jesus. How many glad you're on the winning side? Hallelujah. So, in case you haven't noticed, life is a series of battles. You're going to face a series of giants. Don't you wish it was just one? You're either in a battle, you either just came out of a battle, or you're about to go in one. You drove all the way to church just to hear that, didn't you? Look at somebody say, stay ready. I got good news for you. 1 John 4:4, you are of God, little children, and have overcome them. Past tense. Overcome them, because greater is he that's within you than he that's within the world. 2 Corinthians 2:14, now thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ Jesus. Romans 8:37, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. And we'd all know this one, if God be for us, what? Who can be against us? So when the battles were over, the victory was won, David wrote a song about it. And I want you to notice that 2 Samuel 22 and Psalms 18 are almost identical twins. Some verses are verbatim, word for word. It's a copy, it's a repeat. So if something was put in the Bible twice, how many believe the Lord's trying to say something? It's important. So here's what I want to do. I want to read a couple of excerpts from this passage, and we're going to talk about hinds feet on hinds places. Are you in 2 Samuel 22? Look at verse 2 with me. He uses a lot of analogies here, a lot of metaphors, and he said, the Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, the God of my rock. In him will I trust. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my high tower, my refuge, my savior. Thou savest me from violence. I will call on the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. When the waves of death compassed me, the floods of ungodly men made me afraid. The sorrow of hell compassed me about. The snares of death prevented me. But in my distress, I called upon the Lord and cried to God, my God, and he did hear my voice out of his temple, and my cry did enter into his ears. How many are glad God hears your prayer? He knows what you're going through, and I'll say it this way, the answer is already on the way. I feel that like prophecy this morning. The answer is on the way. You feel like you've been beating your head against the wall. No progress, no visible change. Yeah, but God heard your prayer. He saw your tears, and the answer is on the way. In Jesus' name. Glance all the way down to verse 30. I like this. For by thee I have run through a troop. And by my God have I leaped over a wall. Can you just imagine David in the middle of battle and he's surrounded and the Spirit of God comes upon him and he just runs right through a troop. He's being chased down and there's a barrier, there's a wall in front of him. And he's like, man, they're closing in. They're going to get him this time. And all of a sudden, he just leaps over the wall. Superman style. Hallelujah. Supernatural. Look at verse 31. As for God, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord is tried. He is a buckler, that is a shield to all them who trust in him. For who is God save the Lord? And who is a rock save our God? God is my strength and power. He maketh my way perfect. Now verse 34, read it with me. He maketh my feet like hinds' feet and setteth me on my high places. He teaches my hands to war so that a bow of steel is broken by mine arms. Thou hast also given me the shield of thy salvation, and thy gentleness hath made me great. Look at verse 37. Please read it out loud with me. Thou hast what? Enlarge my steps under me that my feet did not slip. You ought to circle that. You ought to underline that. You ought to highlight it. Whatever you do in your Bible, you need to do it on that verse right there. Because here's what it's talking about. If our feet are like hinds' feet, what is it talking about? It's talking about sure-footedness. Deer are fast. They're nimble. They're agile. They're elusive. They can outrun many predators. They can jump high. They can escape. I like another version. The New Living Translation says, he makes me as sure-footed as a deer, enabling me to stand on mountain heights. Look at somebody say, you're not going to slip. You're not going to fall. Why? Because there's a nail-scarred hand under you, enlarging your steps. Quit worrying that you're going to fail. Quit worrying that you're going to backslide all the time. Hallelujah. God's grace is bigger than that. His grace will sustain you. His grace will keep you. The easy to read version says this. He makes my feet as steady as those of a deer. Even on steep mountains, he keeps me from falling. Ooh, I like that. Have you ever slipped before? Have you ever just wiped out? I mean, embarrassingly so. Oh, yeah. Fall flat on your face. I was weed eating a couple weeks ago, and I was on a steep slope, and there I was weed eating, and I had my old cruddy yard shoes on. There's hardly any tread on the bottom of those things, and I'm buzzing along these weeds, and I'm trying to climb up this steep little slope, and I promise you, my feet went like that. I don't know where the weed eater went, but I did a face plant. And I jumped up and looked around, make sure nobody was seeing me. Man, that was embarrassing. I said, God, I'm glad you're the only one who saw that, because they would have laughed their head off at me. Well, thank you. Thank you. But think about, you've been there where you lost control. It's like, I don't know what's happening here. You lost your balance. You lost your footing. Well, God says, you know what? I'm going to give you hinds feet. I'm going to give you traction. I'm going to give you grip. I'm going to give you sure-footedness. I'm going to enlarge your steps under you so your feet will not slip. I'm not talking about in the natural. I'm talking about in the spiritual. Are you with me this morning? Hallelujah. Spiritually, while many people are slipping and falling, God is giving you sure-footed stability. One of my favorite scriptures is Jude 1:24. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding great joy. How many know there's saving power in the blood of Jesus? Well, I got news for you. There's not only saving power, there's keeping power in the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. He will keep you, preserve you, give you sure-footedness. Praise God. There's a song. There's power, wonder-working power in the blood. And he can keep you upright. Look at this next part here. So hinds feet on high places not only speaks of sure-footedness, it also speaks of elevation. I believe there's a place you can go in God where the enemy can't reach you. Oh, he'll try. You ever seen those shirts and bumper stickers says, can't touch this? One of my favorites, I drive up and down this road, these coal trucks, and every once in a while, one of them will have a Yosemite Sam bumper or mud flap. You know, those two pistols, old Yosemite Sam with that big walrus mustache, and it says, back off. I think of that, and I say, that's right, devil, back off. I'm in the nail-scarred hand of Jesus. I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. My name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I'm headed for heaven. You can try all you want, but I say back off in Jesus' name. Because I'm going higher. Look at somebody and say, I'm going higher. God wants to take you higher than you've ever been. Listen to this. In the Living Bible, it says, he causes the good to walk a steady tread like mountain goats upon the rocks. How many have learned that your attitude often influences your altitude? You can only go as high as your attitude will let you go. My mom had a great sign. It hung, a plaque, it hung for years in her kitchen. We've still got it somewhere, boxed up somewhere, but I loved it. I read it 1,000 times. It says, attitudes are contagious. Is yours worth catching? Hallelujah. I want a can-do attitude. Amen. I want to go higher. I want to elevate. So funny. We took these kids to youth camps many years. Michelle and I took groups of kids over 20 years to different youth camps. And one year, get this, the theme of the camp was elevate. They had t-shirts printed with that word, big, bold letters, elevate. And we stayed, we had Noah, he was real little, so we stayed off campus, and we stayed in a motel, and guess what? The elevator was broke. We had to drag our luggage up flights of stairs to get to our room. Well, they got it fixed before we left, but hallelujah. How many want to go higher in Jesus? Sometimes you feel like you're going against the grain. It's like everything's a struggle, but you don't realize that you're making progress. You're going higher. He's giving you hinds feet so that you can rise up above and elevate. Hallelujah. I like this version. See, deer have special hooves. They're made of keratin, which enable them to climb rugged mountainous terrain. Other animals can't climb. So hinds can go higher where other animals can't reach them. They're out of reach of their predators. The message says this. It says, now I run like a deer. I'm the king of the mountain. How many of you, come on, be honest in church. How many of you played king of the mountain when you were a kid? Or last man standing, whatever you call it. We did. Boy, we had a time. We had a raft. In our lake, we had about a 10-foot by 10-foot wooden raft, and under it, we had big styrofoam floats that kept it aloft. And we would climb onto that, dive off, jump off, cannonballs off, all that stuff. But then we'd say, King of the Mountain, and everybody trying to climb up, and you push them off. And man, it made you feel like the king of the world to stand there and say, I'm the king of the mountain. Well, spiritually, that's what God's going to enable you to do. All the enemy is trying to drag you down, pull you off of that perch. Hallelujah. But in God, you'll stand there and say, I'm the king of the mountain. Hallelujah. Look at somebody and say, you're looking at the king of the mountain. You may not feel that way today, but God says you can do it. Praise the Lord. Hinds feet, you'll walk on your high places. Not only is it talking about sure-footedness, elevation, it's also talking about opportunity. Because to some people, mountains are just obstacles. They're just barriers. To others, they're opportunities to advance, to grow, to learn. Listen, you don't belong in the lowland. You weren't designed for the valley. Yeah, we go through valleys, but you're not designed to stay there. Notice this from Psalm 23. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. It didn't say you're going to stop there. It didn't say you're going to live there. It didn't say you're going to camp out there. No, you're just walking through that valley. Why? Because you're headed to the next mountaintop. Anybody with me this morning? Tell somebody, you don't belong in the valley. That's not your destiny. Your destiny is on the mountaintop. Hallelujah. These hinds, these deer, they have that opportunity to climb higher. And mountains give us a chance to grow, to learn, to test our limits, to stretch our faith. And I like this point. When you're up there, you can see for miles. Gives you new perspective. On the mountain, in the high place, you see things other people don't see. Have you ever noticed this? Have you ever noticed on land everything looks kind of random? You're just driving along in your car, trees block your view, buildings block your view. Everything just kind of looks disorderly and kind of jacked up, as we say these days. But have you ever flown in an airplane? You get up above for a higher perspective. Everything looks planned and neat and orderly. The streets, man, the farms even. Everything looks strategically placed. Well, what changed? Nothing changed except you got a higher perspective. If you're living in the low land of carnality, the low land of the flesh, let me tell you, everything's going to look just disorderly and dysfunctional. But if you can rise up in the spirit up to a higher level, hallelujah, all of a sudden your perspective changes. You say, oh, that's God's design. That's God's purpose. Look at there. Hallelujah. It's not random. It's not an accident. No, it's the hand of providence that is guiding my life. Hallelujah. How many have ever been to Lookout Mountain? A lot of you. I've stood there several times in my lifetime. You stand there on that little ledge, that perch. They say you can see seven states. Now, I didn't go measure it. This is what they say. They say you can see parts of Tennessee, parts of Kentucky, parts of Virginia, parts of South Carolina, North Carolina, Alabama, Georgia, seven states. If you're on a low plane, you can't see a few hundred yards. Michelle and I went to Stone Mountain for our anniversary, not last year, but the year before. How many have ever been to Stone Mountain? Boy, it's nice. You get up on that, you take that, what is that, cable car up there. You get up on top of that big old rocky mountain, and you can see for miles. You can see the skyline of Atlanta for miles. The only problem was when we went, the weather was terrible. Fog had rolled in. Storms had rolled in. We couldn't even see the side of the mountain going up the cable car. They had this big shindig. They had this big fireworks show, laser lights, all this stuff. We couldn't see half of it because a fog had rolled in and blocked our vision. Let me tell you, somebody's there spiritually today. Hallelujah. Your vision has become obstructed. Your vision has been distracted. The enemy has allowed you to look at other things and you're not seeing clearly. But God wants you to rise up above that. He wants to give you new perspective today. To see as he sees. To see things other people don't see. He wants to take you higher. Amen? So we took their word for it. I guess it was a good fireworks show. Here's another one. To have hinds feet on high places. In Bible symbolism, Bible typology, mountains speak of victory, achievement, accomplishment, overcoming. Hallelujah. And just like David overcame every giant he faced, I believe God wants you to overcome. Didn't the Bible say this? I'll make you the head and not the tail. Didn't the Bible say I'll make you above and not beneath? Didn't the Bible say this, that when the enemy comes against you one way, he'll flee seven ways? Didn't he say, I'll bless your basket and your store, and I'll bless your coming in and your going out? Hallelujah. I'm talking about standing on the mountaintop in victory. God wants to give you victory in every area of your life. Yes, we're fallen. Yes, we're flesh. Yes, we're weak. Yes, we're human. Yes, we stumble. But in the grace of God, hallelujah, you can stand back up and still walk in victory. A righteous man may fall 7 times, but what does he do? Gets back up again. Look at somebody say, get back up. Get back up. Hallelujah. If you've ever watched a Rocky movie, the message is real simple. Get back up. Hallelujah. Keep fighting. Keep fighting the good fight of faith. Hallelujah. Don't stay down. Victory is going to give you hinds feet to walk on your high places. Praise the Lord. Now, it's interesting. We find this terminology in this passage, but we also find it in another place in the Bible. Flip over with me to the book of Habakkuk. I bet you haven't been there lately. I'll help you out. It's page 858 in my Bible. That's probably no help at all. Habakkuk is one of 12 so-called minor prophets. That's a misnomer. The reason they're classified as minor prophets is because their books are smaller, shorter than the major prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel. Then you have 12 minor prophets. How many are having trouble finding Habakkuk? Well, this will help you. It's right before Zephaniah and after Nahum. You're getting warmer. Some of you are cheating. You're using thumb index. Look at this about Habakkuk. I want to show you this. Here's what Habakkuk means. His name is very significant. It means embrace or one who embraces or clings. You think about that. Hold on to God no matter what and don't let go. Habakkuk didn't live in good times. Habakkuk lived in terrible times. Habakkuk lived right before the Babylonians came and destroyed Jerusalem, pillaged and plundered and looted the city, took thousands of people away captive. It was a very dark time, a bleak time, a time of dismal despair in Israel. And yet his name means, I'm embracing, I'm clinging, I'm holding on. I'm going to keep embracing what I believe, and I'm going to keep holding on to Jesus no matter what. How many have made that decision today? So he describes this very bleak time, a dismal picture of drought, famine, crop failure, economic recession, war. The Babylonians are coming, remember? Look at verse 17 of chapter 3. Here's what it says. Although the fig tree shall not blossom, no fruit. Neither shall fruit be in the vines. There's no grapes. The labor of the olive shall fail. The trees aren't producing. Maybe because the enemy's come and plucked all the harvest off. It says, and the field shall yield no meat. There's no beef. The flock shall be cut off from the fold. No crops. There shall be no herd in the stalls. You read that and you say, that's depressing. That's discouraging. That's an awful picture. But look at the rest. I like the next verse. Yet. Somebody say yet. I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. You mean you can praise God in the middle of all that? You mean you can still have victory in the middle of all that? You mean to tell me, hallelujah, you can still have a song in the middle of all that? Oh yeah, I will rejoice in the Lord my God. He didn't say, I feel like it. He said, I will. I'm going to exercise my will. Hallelujah. Ties in beautifully with another psalm that we love. I will bless the Lord when? His praise shall what? Two times to praise the Lord. When you feel like it, when you don't. Keep praising him anyway. Hallelujah. When I feel good, when I don't. When I've got plenty to eat, when the cupboard is bare. When business is booming and when it all dries up. when there's a surplus or when there's a shortage, when heaven is raining blessings or when all of hell is coming against me, I'm still going to worship the Lord. If the man I voted for is in the White House or not, it don't matter. I'm still going to praise God. If the stock market is riding a wave or if it's bottoming out, it doesn't matter. I'm still going to worship the Lord. Is anybody getting my drift today? Your victory does not depend on your external circumstance. Your victory depends on your internal relationship with the God who owns it all. Hallelujah. And in the middle of this, Habakkuk uses this same verse. Maybe he heard passed down from his mama and his daddy or his grandparents. He heard about a psalmist named David who wrote this, and he writes the same thing, Habakkuk 3:19. The Lord, the sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to tread upon the heights. He makes me to walk upon my high places. In other words, let me borrow the lyrics from a song. For Him was a great Christian contemporary band. They've disbanded now, but there was a song they sang called Wings. And here's the line. It said, what's over my head will soon be under my feet. All those obstacles, all those barriers, all those insurmountable problems, you think there's no way I'm going to overcome that. When God lifts you up with hinds feet to a higher level, those problems are not looming and lording over you anymore. Hallelujah. They're under your feet. Praise God. How many believe God can lift you up above? I said God can lift you up above it and let you soar on the wings of an eagle. Praise God. Rise above every negative thing you face. Go higher in God. He gives me hinds feet that I may walk on my high places. I want you to do something a little unorthodox. Will you kind of just stomp your feet a little bit? Pretend they're not shoes and feet. Pretend they're hooves. Come on, let's get a stampede going. How doesn't that feel good? Just think about that. How the devil's under your feet. Your problems are under your feet. Hallelujah. Those burdens are under your feet in Jesus' name. Why? He's given you hinds feet. Praise God. So that you can walk on your high places. You know, there is a scripture that says, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news, glad tidings. Well, if I have nothing else going for me, the Bible says I got pretty feet. Hallelujah. So take that, devil. Praise God. Come on, stomp it again. Say, he's under my feet. Those burdens are under my feet. Those worries are under my feet in Jesus' name. Sickness is under my feet. Hallelujah. Every demonic oppression is under my feet. He's given me hinds feet that I can walk on my high places. Those things that were looming over my head are not over me anymore. They're under my feet in Jesus' name. Will you stand with me this morning? Hallelujah. Joan, I want you to come join me right here. I want to pray for you and with you. Hallelujah. Praise God. I thank God for this young man. Will you stretch your hands toward him? Lord, I thank you for what you're doing in Jonah's life. I thank you that he's growing in you. Thank you for how you're using him musically. God, just anoint him in a greater measure. Take him to a higher level, a new dimension in his faith and in his understanding of you. You've called this young man from before he was born. You had a purpose in his life. And I believe, God, you're going to open every door that's of you and slam closed every door that's not of you. In Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. We put our blessing on his life, Lord. Your blessing, your favor. Hallelujah. Give him wisdom. Give him grace. Give him strength to walk with you. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. If you will, play that bass for a minute while we have prayer. Anyone else you want or need? Hello, everyone. This is Pastor Ben Godwin, thanking you for watching our broadcast today. I pray it has been a blessing and a source of spiritual enrichment for you and your family. I'd like to invite you to visit and subscribe to our YouTube channel, where you can view many more singing and preaching videos. Search for Good Springs Full Gospel Church at youtube.com. Also, please visit our website at goodspringsfgc.org, where you can learn more about our church and ministry, read many of my articles on a variety of subjects, find a direct link to our YouTube channel, shop our online store, and donate to our church and help support our TV ministry with debit, credit card, or PayPal. Also, you can mail in an offering the old-fashioned way to Good Springs Full Gospel Church, P.O. Box 3161, Jasper, Alabama, 35502. If we can assist you in any way in your spiritual journey, please contact us. And remember, when all else fails, God's Word works.